You have clicked on this video because you want to know if you should go with X11 or Wayland, or perhaps you just want a better understanding for these things. If you want to skip right ahead to the conclusion, you can go to the last section of this video. But if you want to understand what a display server is and how Linux manages its windows and display, then you should not skip the next sections. X11 and Wayland are both display servers. In Linux, a display server is a fundamental component of the graphical user interface. It is responsible for managing graphical display output and handling user input from input devices such as your keyboard and mouse. It acts as an intermediary between the applications that run on the system and the hardware that displays the graphical elements on the screen. What I just did was read the definition, but to completely understand what a display server is, we will look at the boot up sequence of all the things that happen when you switch the power on button. Do keep in mind that these orders will vary depending on your various Linux distributions, so it's just a vague outlook of things. The first thing that happens is you press the power on button. After that, the BIOS gets loaded and it initializes the hardware, runs the power on self-test, and checks for connected devices. Now, if this test passes, then the bootloader gets loaded and it can be grub, for example. And it allows the user to select the kernel to boot and also provide some other configurations. Now, when you have selected your kernel, it loads the kernel image. Now, kernel gets initialized and it begins the process of booting the root file system. If an init RAM FS is used, it is loaded and unpacked in the memory, providing necessary modules and data for booting the root file system. The kernel loads the device drivers, aka your kernel modules, which are for your hardware components like graphic cards and network adapters. The system's initialization process starts, typically managed by the init systems like systemd, sysvinit, runit, or something else. It initializes various components of the system, such as networking, logging, etc. The init system start service is defined by the unit files and other system services. The system services start the display manager. Sometimes init system can start the display manager as well. It varies on the init system and your unit files. So this can happen as well. The display manager, that is your GDM, LightDM, which is used in Ubuntu, presents the user with the login screen, which is your user authentication step. Now, when the authentication is successful, it starts your user environment, which then starts your display server, and then your display server takes you into your desktop environment, the display server being X11 or Wayland, and your desktop environment being XFCE, GNOME, KDE, so many things. Just so on and on and on. I already told you before what a display server does. Now let's get into how X11 and Wayland are different. X11 project was started at MIT in 1984. Which makes it almost 40 years old. It was a successor to the earlier W Windows system developed at Stanford University. So this is our X Windows system architecture. The X server has connection with the kernel, the evdev, which just stands for event device, and it is a kernel input driver used to handle input events from various input devices. It also has access to KMS, which stands for kernel mode settings, which is responsible for early display configuration, faster mode switching, better graphics performance, and so on. It is called X server because one of the defining features of the X11 protocol is its network transparency, which allows applications to run on remote machines and display their graphical output to a local machine's X server. That means the X client can be a remote X server. So this X client can be a remote X server. Now, for example, let's say in event occurs, FDev sends it to the X server. So this is the step one. X server decides which client to send it to. The client acts upon that event and sends it back to the server. So this is step two, this is step three. Then the X server sends it to the compositor, which does its thing and sends it back to the X server. So this is four and this is step five. And it finally comes to the KMS, which is then responsible for displaying the result. So there are six steps involved. Due to the network transparency feature and the nature of X11 request response model, there can be noticeable latency when interacting with remote X11 clients, leading to reduced performance for real-time and interactive tasks. It can also introduce security risk, as sensitive information such as keystrokes and screen content may be transmitted over the network without encryption by default. This can be mitigated by using SSH tunneling or other secure mechanisms, but it requires additional configuration. The window manager is just an X client, and it is redundant because of the fact that it is performing tasks both as a client and manager which oversees other applications. As a result, it needs to communicate with the X server as a client while simultaneously managing other client windows and their interactions. The compositor here has two buffers. The one is the front buffer that is visible. The back one is where the things are rendering. It can then also add different visual effects like transparency, drop shadows, fading animations, and window transformation. Once all of these visual effects are applied, the compositor blends the content of the back buffer with the desktop background, which is the root window, using alpha blending. Now, this process is really slow because you didn't actually use the GPU for doing all of this. Well, you couldn't, because when X11 came out, GPUs were not a thing. Also, a lot of code has been there since the past 35 years that is not needed anymore, and it counts as bloat. It gets regular updates, but it really needs a major overhaul, but a lot of original developers are now not active. The memory can be shared between two clients directly using the MIT SHM extension, but it's not safe considering today's standards. Let's open our Void Linux in recovery mode because this is an XFCE version. I've installed it on the VirtualBox. To start the X server, we can just type the X command. The display server is now running, but there are no processes running on top of the X server, so we don't see anything. For that, let's close the X server and use the xinit command instead. It calls a startup script that can start the window manager that you want as default. The startup script is in the root directory and it is known as .xinitrc. I don't have that script, so it just starts an X terminal. Let's open a simple chess game, which is an X application in the background. You can see that there is no ability to move this application around because there is no window manager. Let's start a window manager as well. I will start open box and you can see now we have the ability to move this chessboard around. Let's open some more X applications like X Leonard, which is just a simple game, and X OS View, which tells about your system data like CPU load and memory. If we go to our terminal now and get the list of jobs, you can see that these are all just X client, and you can simply kill the window manager using the process ID. So if we kill the window manager, which is the process 2, you see that we're back with the inability to move anything around because the window manager is just an X client and we can easily kill it. Now let's close all of this and create that xinitrc file that I was talking about. We'll open our nano editor and create this file, which is in the root directory. We'll just tell it to start our awesome window manager. So this is all you need to do. Now we just have to save this and exit. Now when you will call xinit, you can see that our awesome window manager starts and we can open a terminal and yep. So this is how this works. Let's now close this X server and talk about Wayland and the problems it fixes. Wayland was started by Christian Hogsberg, a software engineer at Red Hat, in 2008. The development of the Wayland was initiated as an effort to create a more modern and efficient display protocol to display the aging X window system. It adopted a more modern design, focusing on direct rendering, reducing communication overhead, and better supporting for modern hardwares and input devices. It aimed to be a more straightforward and streamlined display protocol that could take advantage of the capabilities of modern graphics hardware. Let's take a look at our Wayland architecture. Here, the roles of a window manager and a display server is combined into a single component called the compositor. The compositor is responsible for managing windows, handling input events, and rendering graphics directly to the screen. It has the access to KMS, FDev, and kernel as well. When an event occurs, FDev sends it to the Wayland compositor. The compositor sends it to the appropriate client. The client responds to that event and sends their buffer update to the compositor, which also acts as a window manager. You notice that the communication protocol is now more streamlined and simpler compared to X11. Compositor does its thing and sends it to KMS. So in total, there are just 4 steps. There are a lot less steps than X11, and Window Manager is just not another client anymore. The security is better and it follows today's standard. It uses a server-side rendering model where the compositor performs rendering directly to the screen. Application sends buffer update to the compositor, which then composites the buffers and displays them. The input handling is simpler and more consistent. It can use hardware acceleration for direct rendering. The window decorations are directly in the compositor, which allows for a more consistent look and feel and less screen tearing. You should use X11 when you need compatibility with older software, since many applications are written for X. However, you can still run these applications in Wayland using a compatibility layer called X-Wayland. Depending on your hardware and graphics driver, X11 might offer better stability and performance due to the longer development and driver support history. If you frequently use remote desktop or access applications over a network, X11's network transparency feature can be beneficial. X11 offers a wide range of customization and advanced features that some users might prefer or require for their specific workflow. You can prefer Wayland when you're using modern graphics and higher refresh rate displays because there is a lot less screen tearing and it provides a smoother and more efficient display experience. It has improved security over X11 as it avoids some of the potential security vulnerabilities present in the X11 network transparency model. If you're using touch-based devices, Wayland provides better support for touch input and gesture recognition. Many new and modern applications are being developed with Wayland support in mind, and using Wayland will ensure that you can take advantage of the latest softwares and features. For a more general user and beginner in Linux, I would say that you start with the default display protocol provided by your Linux distribution. Most modern Linux distributions are adopting Wayland as their default display server, especially for newer hardwares and installations. Wayland is becoming more mature and widely supported, and it offers several advantages, including improved performance and security. However, if you encounter any issues with Wayland or specific applications you need to use are not yet fully compatible, you can switch back to X11 temporarily because KDE, Neon, Ubuntu, and some other distros offer the ability to choose X11 or Wayland on the login screen. The choice between X11 and Wayland largely depends on the specific use case and hardware configuration. Let me know what you will use in the comment section below. Thank you for watching.